The Willamette Valley is a great place to grow just about anything. But there's a new crop on the landscape that some are betting will be Oregon's next Pinot Noir.
Olives are an interesting story. I think it's a crop that drags you in, you know, pulls you in, and makes you very passionate about it.
That's right, olives. OSU researcher Javier Fernandez-Salvador turned that passion into the Olea project, a program designed to put Oregon olive oil on the gastronomic map.
We want to make the crop viable and cost-effective so that we can grow the industry a little more.
Yeah, with these size trunk.
You almost can't even tell on this tree that you lost anything, you know?
Yeah.
But the thing is, this is a tree that's native to the Middle East.
It's a region where it's very dry in the summer and not particularly cold in the winter. So in Oregon, we had the challenge of dealing with the winter.
You see where there's no leaves and it looks dried and ugly? Yeah, that's cold damage.
Oregon's chilly winters can damage the buds that become olives in the spring or kill the trees outright.
This bottom part is looking great, but this top, yeah. Look at that.
Case in point, the ice storm of February 2021.
Oh my God.
Look at that, it lost all this.
It lost all of its top.
It lost the top.
The idea of the project was to see if there's varieties that are more tolerant, and then to see if there are techniques that we can use to establish the orchard faster so that it doesn't get hit by the cold as much.
Some of that work now happens in OSU's greenhouses and fields here in Aurora. But it started in the early 2000s with some adventurous growers.
How was the storm?
It was bad.
This is the guy that fell down?
Well, there's quite a few of them. There's about 15. But then you can see, like, this guy toppled over completely. So we're just trying to support it.
Wow.
Marnie Redding is one of those early pioneers.
I've been doing this for about 14 or 15 years. There was a group of us that talked with each other and communicated, and it just felt like a fun project to learn something completely new. They were all fluffy and pretty, and now they look like they've had a hard winter. And they have. Yeah. Two have died for sure so far.
Keeping these heat-loving fruit trees alive demands patience and a willingness to adapt.
Yeah. That's what I would do.
I have about 75 trees in my barn, basically just to replace trees that I lose in the winter.
Like sometimes you see damage to a third, half of your trees. That's why it's so challenging in Oregon. And over here, you start to get up the hill and they start to look fantastic.
Yeah, that's a great tree. Look at that tree. It's harder than it looks. I mean, when you come out here, it looks like a really successful olive grove, but I know all the years that it's taken to get it just to this point. So it's a process. But I love bringing home my own olive oil that's grown on the property and just trying to figure out what works and what doesn't. I'll be curious to see what the yield is this year.
Yeah.
Like Marnie, winemaker and now olive grower Paul Durant has learned a lot of this the hard way.
Oh my, that is some trimming.
Yeah, we really whacked them back. For sure.
Wow.
In 2005, we planted our first few thousand trees. Got super excited because they did so well. And then the real learning started to happen with a series of cold winters and incorrect varietals and all sorts of things. But you have to just keep iterating around where can we borrow, beg, steal ideas. And so we're spreading our trees out further apart now. We're continuing to try things, you know, just even this weed mat really put down not so much for weed control, but for heat retention. If we can get them to wake up maybe even 2 weeks earlier in the spring, that gives us 2 weeks more ripening in the fall.
Another big problem for us here in Oregon is our season is much shorter than what it would be in California. So it bears fruit later with the time where we're starting to get really cold. So we have to harvest it quick.
Growing olives is tough, but experts used to say wine grapes wouldn't do well here either. And we all know how that turned out. Could it be the same for olives?
The reason why people didn't want to grow grapes here, it's because of our rain. But there are grapes that you can grow with those limitations and still make a fantastic product. The limitation is not so much the cold. With olives, that's the main limitation.
That doesn't deter Paul Durant.
For anybody that's in agriculture in Oregon, it's a long-term venture, and you gotta be thinking what crop can be adapted into a changing climate. And honestly, the olives are just at the beginning stages of that.
Okay, so does a change in climate mean olives might thrive here someday?
We don't know. Our summers may be drier. That's great for olives.
Where do you want to start, Javier?
This good? Will this make winters warmer? We don't know. It's not a crop where you're like, oh, will I get a good harvest or not this year? No, it's a crop where you're like, will I lose all of my trees this year? So you probably have to ask a climatologist, and they're not going to be able to predict it either.
After the icy winter, a mild fall has given Marnie Redding just the harvest window she'd hoped for.
So are they different varieties?
Yeah, I have about 5 different varieties.
So you blend them?
Yep. Okay. Mm-hmm. It's a Tuscan blend.
Tuscan blend? Mm-hmm. Right here in Oregon.
I know.
Scientists tell us our overall climate is getting warmer, but they're also seeing more extremes in temperature and precipitation.
So are we going to find the next Pinot that will make Oregon oil famous?
Wonderful to it.
If we didn't have those cold winters, but we do. So we're constantly struggling. So why do we do it, right? There's so many different flavors and tastes and textures and qualities that you can get out of an olive oil that it just involves you. So this is your 2020 harvest.
Yes.
Yeah, wow. Look at the color.
Isn't that beautiful?
It's so vibrant. The magnificent thing about Oregon is because of all of our limitations, we produce fantastic oils. Look at that greatness. And that gives the growers an opportunity for that really high-end, high-value niche market.
Like fresh cut grass. Mm-hmm. Mm. I get a little bit of clover now too. Then peppery. And then the finish is very nutty now. It's fantastic.
It really is. And that's why we do it.
Yeah, this is why we do it, exactly.
Great people just doing their thing in their own Northwesty way. We love bringing you stories like this. Support what you love. OPB.org/video.